All right, let's go ahead and get started. I wanted to thank everybody for joining today, our webinar about AI and how its innovative technologies that is addressing recruiting and labor market data. I am Andy Najjar, Chief Operating Officer here at FutureSolve. And what we do at FutureSolve is we're a HR advisory firm that helps companies find technology and decide on strategies and directions when it comes to people. And today, we wanted to introduce two great companies that we know about. One is Greenwich.HR, Carrie, and Simon from QJumpers. So I'll go ahead and have each of them introduce themselves, how long they've been in the space, what they currently are working on, and then we'll go through the session from there. Carrie, you want to go first?
Great, thanks. And it's a pleasure to be here today. I'm Carrie Sparrow. I'm the CEO and founder of Greenwich.HR. I founded the company in 2015, really as a way to bring more transparency to the labor market, coming out of careers in both leadership in consulting, HR consulting, as well as corporate HR leadership.
Great. Nice to have you, Carrie.
Thanks.
Cool. And I'm Simon Oldham. I'm CEO and co-founder of QJumpers. QJumpers, we originated from New Zealand, where we started off as really a talent pool system back in 2006. We merged to become, or kind of pivoted is the key word nowadays, into an applicant tracking system. And recently, we've been doing a lot of work in the AI space, working on, you know, how to make the recruitment processes more efficient, but also how to source talent in a market that traditional methods of finding people is just not working. So we've recently released a new product called AI Talent Sourcing, and that's really to try and help our clients to get to the best people as fast and easy as possible when the traditional methods aren't working.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much, Simon, for that. Well, let's go ahead and get into the exciting part, which is, first off, let's talk about actually the job market outlook. I know today there's a lot of changes that's happened, even more changes than last year and the year before that. It was definitely an employee dominant market where everybody was, you know, seeking talent, maybe not even finding enough talent. But Carrie, I know that you have an innovative way to look at the labor market data on a real-time basis. So I was wondering, what are you seeing in the market today from your side? And then we'll go to Simon and see what you're seeing from what you're hearing on your side.
Right. So when we look at what companies are hiring for, and we measure that by what they're advertising for and how much they're expecting to pay from those positions. And I can talk a little bit about how we do that as we dive into this. But when we look at that, we're seeing continued historic strong demand across the vast majority of types of jobs and industries. While the demand is tapered off a bit from where it was the end of 2021, the beginning of 2022, it's still, in historic terms, is still very, very strong. We're also seeing really high wage inflation. So over the past 20 months, advertised wages have gone up by 30% across all markets, all jobs. And that varies pretty dramatically across markets and jobs. In some cases, it's much higher. In fact, about 25% of jobs are now running more than 50% higher in terms of pay than Wow. they were a year ago. But in some cases, it's lower. And so it's really variable depending on the job or the market. But the overall trend is continued higher wage pressure. And that's a wage pressure that I think is definitely more pronounced at lower paying levels as starting wages are going up. But it is not exclusive to those types of jobs. It's also very prevalent at higher paid salary jobs as well.
Wow, awesome. I like that outlook. 30 to 50% more is definitely a big increase in salary growth, probably more than inflation itself. Simon, from your end, when it comes to recruiting talent, finding talent, what are you finding is the norm today? Or are they saying it's easy to find talent, hard to find talent? How?
Yeah. It's interesting to hear what Carrie says, because he's got access to some, you know, real-time excellent data that not everyone does. And my information is really anecdotally from what our clients are telling us and what we're seeing out there. So the main thing is the number of jobs that is being advertised is just starting to decrease compared to what it was a few months ago. Compared historically, it's still very, very high, and it's still, there's still a lot more jobs than there are people. And that's the key driver, the key dynamic that's really impacting everything when it comes to not only the recruitment space, but the HR space, and what people are needing to do to combat this skills shortage, this labor talent shortage that we still have. And it has, yes, it's impacted on salaries. Carrie talked to, about that. Huge impact on salaries, but also strategies around engagement. Companies have done a lot of work around engagement, around culture, benefits, all ways to try and improve retention. They've built in new strategies on retraining people that they didn't put as much focus on before. They're looking at skills. Because they know that it's so hard to replace people, it's so hard to find new people that, okay, what can we do with the people we do have? Can we retrain them? Are there people in the company? Let's look across internal mobility. Is there someone that has the skills that I need that can do this job? Let's not look at experience. Are there skills that can impact? When it comes to recruiting and sourcing, things have changed. The old ways of recruiting, of sourcing, of finding talent, they're gone. If you're out there and you're just using job board advertising like you used to, you're going to be behind the game, because you need to be fast and you need to be fishing where the fish are. And you need to be talking the same language. You need the right bait that they are going to eat so they get on your hook. So sourcing is really key. And so, yeah, we've got this AI sourcing product, and people are doing a lot more with AI, so that you know that you can find the people that have the skills that you need for your job. You can get their contact details, and you can start to put in some processes, some places, some automated tools, if you can, to start communicating, start engaging, to get these people to take a bite at the hook and talk to them. If you can, get a conversation going with them faster than what you did in the past. Just don't wait until they apply for an ad, and then wait until everybody's applied for an ad, and don't do 5 interviews. It's like, find who is the best person, give them a call, make them an offer. It's all about speed and finding the right skills as fast as possible.
Yeah, and Simon, you're referring to something that Ear at FutureSolve, one of our founders, labels as talent access. So a lot of times it was referred to as talent acquisition, which, you know, there's a big joke in the office that, you know, you don't acquire talent; they're not your ownership. And this is something, a terminology you use in logistics, but talent access is actually accessing talent, even if they're not looking for a job. It's building relationships, building deep pools of people that would be looking at these jobs and know about your culture and the type of company you are, even before they actually make the jump. And so you're talking about ways of actually finding talent that is even passive, and just reaching out to them and beginning the conversations to see even if there's interest, and if there is interest, moving fast on that, which I definitely feel that it's the future. That's what we're seeing. You know, the old way of, you know, posting and hoping is going away. And it's now more about, how do we be proactive about the jobs? How do we approach talent? And even sometimes just tell them about our company before they even get, you know, given a job, or telling them that there's a position open. Carrie, you mentioned some really good data about the industry, like some of the changes. But I want to know, like, how do you get that data? You know, is it, you know, how old is it, or how new is it, and where do you get that insights, and how do companies could get access to that insight? So if you can give us a little bit more info there, that'd be great.
Yeah, sure. I'd love to talk about that. So Greenwich.HR operates a real-time market intelligence data platform where we're collecting data every day about almost all the open jobs in a given country. In the US, we track about 80% of all the new jobs that are being created in the US. So millions of online job listings are being reviewed every day, and intelligence is being extracted from them using methods that we developed that are proprietary to us. And we're able to glean things like who's hiring, what kinds of jobs are they hiring for, how long are the listings staying open, but also really importantly, what is the expected pay levels for those jobs? And we're able to do that at a very high rate. About 70% of the jobs that we track, we're able to get a pretty precise view of what companies expect to pay for those jobs. And then all the different attributes, you know, so the skills, the experience levels, education levels, and so forth, we're able to get there. And because all that data originates in the public domain, we can provide it to our clients in a way that's totally transparent. So one of the things that, you know, has become a real pronounced need just since late 2021, traditional sources of information about, you know, what prevailing wage rates are, for example, what demand for certain kinds of jobs, the labor market went completely out of bounds last year in terms of traditional expectations around growth rate and wages, understandings of who's competing for what talent, and so forth. And it went so far out of bounds that a lot of conventional wisdom was no longer applicable. So for example, you know, the conventional wisdom has always been, and with a lot of truth, that generally employees don't leave for a better pay. They don't leave a company for a better pay. They leave because of bad management and bad culture, and they see a better opportunity somewhere else. That's not true anymore. When you've got employees that are receiving offers where the pay level is 30, 50, 70% higher than what they're making today, and in today's inflation environment, that has a meaningful impact on their families, not just their careers, not just their work environment. And so understanding what's happening in the market has become more critical than ever. And employers with traditional data sources have been flying blind. They've really been flying blind. So what we've done is brought a way to see what's happening with a level of transparency and a level of real time that has never been available before. We have a compensation intelligence and hiring intelligence product called WageScape that lets people see as of right now, who's hiring for what jobs, what the prevailing rates are, what the trends are across any location, any kind of job, any company, any time period, updated on a daily basis. So it's all very real time. It's a new realm of data available for understanding what's going on in the market. It's also a great competitive intelligence tool because you can see exactly who's hiring for what kinds of jobs. For example, one of our clients is a machine shop operator, and that's, you know, skilled labor that now is finding that they're competing for talent against a lot of entry-level quick service restaurants and retail jobs that are paying as much or more as what they've historically paid. That's unprecedented. So the whole, you know, to Simon's point, the whole approach around retaining and recruiting has really, companies are having to get much more innovative and creative in terms of how they deal with that and set aside a lot of prior assumptions about what challenges they had to face.
Wow, that is really powerful. And one of the things I wanted to mention is, so your data would help somebody even know if they're posting a job, where the job is, where the people are, where the skills are in that category. So they, and then even what to pay when they're, you know, planning for that, which today is, there's a big trend of moving away from job descriptions and a focus on skills. So where are that skill set? Where is that skill set? Does it even exist? Do we need to train the skill set to bring people that just could be trained, or does it already exist that we can bring on, specifically with innovative companies that are creating new things, you know, new areas of business? Sometimes those skills, it would help to know if those exist or not. Simon, when it comes to skills, you've also taken a new approach on looking at, you know, hiring and approaching talent without a resume and without a job description, pretty much, right? So it's skill set. Can you tell us more about that? Like, can you search How does it search? What does it find? You know, how does it look at an individual specifically?
Yeah, yeah, that's a great question. And it feeds on to what I was starting to talk about earlier is recruiting for skills is becoming a necessity now, and people need to mix up how they are recruiting. So what we look at is we can actually look at a job ad, and we can work out, not, you know, we don't just extract what they write, we extract what they mean. So with AI, we can read a job ad and say, okay, they say this, but what they're actually looking for is that. And so we can create a specification, and then we can use AI to search for those skills criteria in our system. We also know that, okay, if they're talking about a certain, let's say they talk about a commercial pilot, they're looking for a commercial pilot, and someone says, oh, yeah, I've flown a 747. They don't say they're a commercial pilot. We know they're a commercial pilot because they've flown a 747. So there's all these skills lexicons and how closely related different skills are. And then you can, with AI, you can work out, okay, they're saying this. Someone else has got a skill that's kind of like that, but not quite like that. We can work out how closely related they are. Even if a person doesn't say on their resume, hey, I've got this skill, we know they've got this skill with AI, because, you know, if you talk about, you know, the technology space, development, developers, communication is typically not, you know, their strong point. They're good at developing code. And so when they write a resume, you can't always get what you need. But through AI, we actually know what they can do without them saying what they do. So when it comes to recruiting for skills now with AI, with these millions and millions of different lexicons and the ability to learn, the systems can learn new words, new skills as they come on, and people start talking about them. So you don't just need to be constricted to this list of current skills. With AI, it can hear a new skill, it can put it in its memory bank until it hears it enough and often enough to be able to place it in a skills lexicon related to other words, so that now it understands a new skill. And when someone says, hey, I want this, it knows what it is. Or if someone says, hey, I've got this, it knows what it is. And so with this technology out there now, we can search the web. We don't need a resume. We can just look at what people are talking about on the web. We can, you know, if they've got LinkedIn, that's all very cool, but anyone can say that. They can do anything on LinkedIn. You can actually go away, validate it. You can see where they are on the web, what they're talking about, what they're looking at, what they're reading. And you can create an online resume of every person that's on the web without them having their own resume. So resumes are becoming a thing of the past. It's all going to be online data that will create a persona and a profile, which makes it so easy with technology to be able to match skills through online technology and AI.
That's really interesting. So I caught on a few things that I wanted to mention, and I wanted to reiterate, I think, is so you, when somebody says they have a skill, let's say on LinkedIn, sometimes they could maybe just fake it or add it in there just because it's a cool skill to add, but yeah, they haven't really done the job that has that skill. Yeah. So are you saying that you're looking at other sites and other places online to make sure that there's a holistic view of that individual and bringing those profiles together to create what they truly have from a skill set perspective?
Yeah, yeah, that's exactly right. So there's thousands and thousands of different places that you know, we can go and bring back individual pieces of data about a person. And LinkedIn is a nice starting point because it's about a person and their skills are related to work. But like you say, yeah, you can be a rocket scientist if you want online and never ever done anything to do with rocket science. So yeah, we can go away to different places and validate it. And wherever we find a piece of information, we can then, it's like a jigsaw puzzle. We pull it from here, we pull it from here, we validate it from here, and then we create an online profile from thousands of different sources for a person.
That's great. And then there's one other point you mentioned, that you create basically a resume of an individual from those different jigsaw puzzles and pieces that you find online. We all know that actually not everybody is a good resume writer. And there's actually a stat that 45% of people that apply to a job get, you know, rejected by the system just because they wrote the resume wrong, even though they may have the skill set that they need, specifically with applicant tracking systems. So what you're saying is we're writing the resume for them based on their real skills, even if they didn't say any skills online, just by the jobs that they performed and having some kind of log or footprint of them doing it, we can also assume the right skills based on the job that they performed and add that as a resume for them versus trying to ask them for building a resume. Is that correct?
Yeah, for sure. And how many people embellish their resume? When they're writing a resume, I'm fantastic at that, I'm great at that, because they're trying to get a job. It's a resume is not a real true life pictation of a person, whereas we try to go out and find the real person. And there's technologies now which a lot of organizations are using, enterprise companies are using now, where they read a resume, they transcribe the resume, and they then use that information to make a hiring decision. And you know, have they said this? And they're matching keywords. Matching a keyword is not a good way to find who is the best fit for an organization. And you know, just really topically became last week, I think it was, this new AI Bill of Rights, mm-hmm. talking about using AI for matching people in recruiting. That kind of technology of using someone's resume and matching it to a job ad or a job description, that's kind of outdated technology now. You shouldn't be doing that, because it's matching on a keyword. If you look actually what a person can do without them actually saying it, if you can get this online profile of a person and you can validate what they can do, and even if they don't say they can do it, but you know they can do it, then mm-hmm. you're starting to get better matches.
Correct. Yeah, absolutely. Based on sometimes personality types or similar jobs that may have similar types of people that could operate in the same way. A big trend I learned about recently is like cybersecurity. Apparently, a lot of the companies think an IT person is a perfect cybersecurity person, but the personality traits of a cybersecurity person is Army, FBI, police officers, because they're actually people that look for threats, right? And they're always on arm to say, hey, what's the next threat and how can I find a way to deviate or address it? And so that's becoming a big gap. So if you know that and you can plan for it, you can even find individuals that have similar personality traits or similar backgrounds and train them in cybersecurity, because they're actually in cybersecurity alone, there's 3 million jobs that won't be addressed in 2023. And so we need to find talent somewhere else. So how do we plan for that? And Carrie, similar to you, many companies may not know how to build a job description. How are you helping them understand the skill set? Like maybe they might have a summary of the job, but not the right skills that they may even need. Do you help them have an outlook of what that looks like or even visibility into that?
Yeah, so visibility into how skills requirements are evolving, I think, is one of the key things that that we offer. And so, you know, even for similar titles, what companies need now looks very different than it did 2 years ago, even a year ago. And so how those are evolving, I think, is critical insights for hiring managers. So similar to what Simon was talking about in terms of being able to understand kind of what an individual's experiences are, understanding what an organization's requirements are things that we can bring to the table, and understanding more generally what a job family and how that's evolving, which is useful for for hiring companies. It's useful for recruiters, recruiting firms. It's useful for folks that are looking to how their organization needs to evolve in terms of things like automation, remote work, outsourcing, and so forth. That's the area where the kind of data that we bring to the table really shows what the market is doing.
Great, awesome, Carrie. And so Simon, and then I'll go back to you, Carrie. Simon, what we all know that there's no technology that's like one size fits all or addresses all the needs. What are things that you're seeing that may be utilized alongside of what you're building or working on? I mean, is it just your tech, or are there other things that also pile on that could help, but would love to learn more?
Yeah, I'm a big believer in best of breed and of doing what you do really, really well. And now we do recruiting and sourcing. That's what we focus on. But you know, we know that our clients, through the process of before they even need to hire, you know, planning the hire, planning the strategy, advertising, sourcing, managing the applicants, background checks, interviewing, there's a whole lot of things in between before a person starts the job. So we like to work with other innovative companies to make sure that from our platform, our clients can get everything they need without having to leave our platform. Mm-hmm. And I mean, one of the things we've just Carrie and WageScape, we've just implemented WageScape as part of our sourcing tool. So you know, we are not a data provider, and we don't have this market information that Carrie has and WageScape. So you know, we partner with innovative companies like that. So now someone can come and create their whole recruitment strategy using the data from WageScape, and then they can come and source and find the people using our AI sourcing. So that's one example, but there's a whole lot of other things out there. There's, you know, communication. I talked about the importance of getting to people really quickly. Automated communication and marketing type tools are important as well. So being able to do that quick, you know, with people working all over the place and being able to hire anyone from anywhere in the world basically now for your company with, you know, work from home. Obviously, you know, video interviewing platforms like this, Zoom, or whatever you use, Spark Hire, that's really important because it's helping with the speed and the efficiency of the hiring process. We do build other tools as well as much as we can. So we do have AI tools within the system to be able, you talked about the talent, not acquisition, but the talent access. So we've just recently built an AI tool that will use the same AI technology that sources people from the web to look at the people in your talent pool as well. So you have ready access to those people there. But then, you know, how do you know they're the right fit? So there's assessment providers. So we integrate with assessment providers. We integrate with the HR systems, obviously, because once you've made a hire, you then employ the person, you then want to be, you know, managing the person and your payroll system and your learning and development system, et cetera. So we integrate with those as well. So there's a whole ecosystem, and we're continually on the lookout for what is new, what is innovative, what is changing the space of recruitment to make this process a lot easier to get to the best person as fast as possible. And so we're always looking at that. But we come from that best of breed kind of an angle.
Yeah, Simon, and thanks for mentioning that. I did see the press release last week between Greenwich.HR and QJumpers and how they're partnering. Simon, or Carrie, I wanted to ask you from your point of view. So you've always used labor market data, and your client base was always compensation and teams within compensation. But you're now seeing that there's also a new use case where this labor market intelligence could really help recruiters and people that are looking for talent or planning for talent. Can you tell us more about how that applies and what type of things they could do, and, you know, how you see the partnership with QJumpers, that pivot could really bring value to the ideal, you know, recruiting teams out there?
Yeah, so understanding what's happening in the market as it relates to, you know, who your competitors are for specific types of talent, and what it takes to compete successfully for those has just become a really pronounced need. And we're seeing in the recruiting space, the desire to equip recruiters and hiring managers with real-time insights in terms of, because everyone competing for your talent is also a potential source for talent themselves. Mm-hmm. So understanding who's in the space and what kind of talent's being hired, what kind of wage rates are being hired and so forth is essential. And it's essential to know that right up front. We're also seeing the real desire and opportunity around embedding market intelligence into the tools that folks are already using to source talent, which is why the partnership with QJumpers is so ideal. So the ability to marry real-time market intelligence with next-generation talent sourcing capabilities in the tool that recruiters are already using is a perfect match. We're seeing that across the board, I would say. So not more and more services that are being offered to the recruiting space, you will see having embedded real-time market intelligence in them, because those are the folks that are coming to us and asking for that kind of capability. If you're a recruiting firm, there's even more value. So the ability to understand where there are new potential clients, understand how well you're doing serving your existing clients, so really helping with that account strategy and account development, that relationship, and the ability to look at which markets are particularly good for sourcing specific kinds of talent are all additional sources of value if you're managing recruiting capabilities or you're managing a recruiting firm.
Wow, so you can even maybe identify companies that are maybe struggling with hiring and that are not able to fill the jobs in the time they want, and be able to find them and approach them and say, we're here to support and help.
Exactly. That's what several of our recruiting firm clients actually do, is in terms of being able to figure out where their services are going to be the most valuable based on how long it's taking folks to fill certain kinds of positions, or whether or not what they're offering or the way they've configured those positions is aligned with what candidates are seeing from other firms in the market.
Great. Well, thank you both. I wanted to open up to the attendees that we have online to see if there's any specific questions that they have. So we'll give everybody here 1 minute. If you do have a question, feel free to put it in the chat. Both to Carrie and Simon, I'm sure that they'll be eager to answer those for you. Waiting for that. Okay, we have one question from the attendees. This is, I think, for you, Carrie. It's asking about the data. Is your data global or is it just US based?
So we collect data from 57 countries. Wow. We're not able to get pay data from all those countries, but in terms of who's hiring and what they're hiring for, we get it from 57 countries that represent all continents except Antarctica.
Wow, that's great. And so we have another question that came in, and that's, I think, for you, Simon. What are the next features that you're looking at when it comes to your AI talent sourcing?
It's almost giving away our kind of secret sauce and roadmap, but I'll tell you. We're pretty open about that. Now, always in our roadmap is we're up to kind of phase two, really phase three, but we want to, like, our tool can go out and find the people for you. But what we have found is that people are struggling to convince them to apply for their jobs. Or to engage with them. So we're building an engagement tool to help, once you've found the people that you think are the right fit, different ways of connecting with them, attracting them, getting them open, to help to open the lines of communication so that they will talk to you so that you can convince them to apply for your job. So that's the next biggest step in our product roadmap.
Well, yeah, because I read an article that said it's like a minimum of 3 touch points before somebody even responds, even if they are interested. So how do you do that? And is it email, text messaging, you know, WhatsApping? You know, there's all kinds of ways that people are reaching out these days. So that is definitely a big area today in how we engage the workforce. Okay. Well, I wanted to be conscious of time and thank everybody for attending. Simon and Carrie, it was really a pleasure having you. If you would like to look at the demo for Greenwich HR or QJumpers, you can actually request right on even FutureSolve's website, and we're happy to coordinate it directly with Simon and Carrie. But want to make sure that we bring up some innovative tech that is in hiring today and talk about it and update everybody on what's happening in the market. So hopefully you had found this helpful, and we do these on a monthly basis. So if you'd like to join our next one, we'd love to have you attend as well. Thank you all. And we look forward to the next conversation. Thank you, Simon. Thank you, Carrie.
Okay. Thanks for having us.
Thanks very much.